Okay, let's start. Good afternoon. My name is Alexander Herzig and I'm the release manager of Container as a Service platform. I'm new to the company. I started in January and I have the pleasure to introduce you to OpenSUSE Cubic and what it is about. So we started with a question. The industry is getting more and more complex. The application delivery supply chain has changed, so nowadays, as you all know, we have shared code repositories like GitHub or Git. We have continuous integration, we have continuous development, we have cloud computing, and the ultimate driver nowadays are containers. So, then there are microservices, and they are fun to use because they make you scale your application pretty easy. In the beginning, we had monolithic approaches that do not meet our requirements nowadays anymore. Then we have VMs, but still they are adding significant resources and management overhead to use. And running apps in containers is pretty much cooler. But we need new tools to automate things and make life easier developing and working with containers. So this is why we came up with the project Cubic. We wanted to set up clusters that should be easy to deploy, easy to set up, and as well should be easy to maintain. Let's talk about containers shortly. Containers are based, or container-based architectures are growing. Containers in the past gained huge popularity. Containers change the IT infrastructure we have today. Containers speed up application delivery, as we know. And containers make us able to port across multiple environments also. And containers help us to scale our applications much faster. So what containers need is a container hosting OS that helps us using containers. So we redesign the operating systems to the needs of containers. And with Cubic, redesigned the way an OS is. We are combining a powerful stack, which is based on OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, SaltStack, the Docker project, and Kubernetes. So what we're asking you by introducing this project to you is build with us the next generation of container OS. Project Cubic, or OpenSUSE Cubic, will be as Tumbleweed, a rolling release, and the following speakers will introduce you into the cool features that the project Cubic will bring to you and shows you how easy it is to pre-configure your system so you don't need no additional configurations afterwards. We also introduce our very own dashboard to bootstrap and maintain a cluster for you. So.
Okay, my name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm the architect at SUSE, mainly responsible for the enterprise server, but also for SUSE Container as a Service product new, and with me is Federica.
I'm Federica, I'm the project manager slash PO for the upper part of the stack.
Okay, so the first question I think most of you have, what is OpenSUSE Cubic? Who of you know our new product development, which is SUSE Container as a Service platform based? Okay, some people know it, not everybody, but yes. So we are planning, or when we developed SUSE Container as a Service platform based on SLES, it was also clear we wanted to have it based on OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, because there are a lot of stuff fitting and it should also be there for community to base their own things on it, bring in their own ideas. And that's why we decided to make an OpenSUSE Cubic release. OpenSUSE Cubic or SUSE Container as a Service is an operating system focused only on containers, so a microservice operating system. We will have minimal images designed for one special use case, versus minimal is not really in size, because if you have all these Go applications and so on, it can become really big with containers, additional then, but minimal in only one service and not a general purpose operating system. We plan to use transactional updates to update the system, and we focused on large deployments, which also means reduced end-user interaction, because if you have to install several hundred machines, you don't want to go around and enter a lot of data, but everything should be taken from existing sources as fast as far as possible. The whole thing should be ready to run, so I install it, I have my web page or dashboard and can start working and don't need to set up and configure a whole Kubernetes cluster. The updates or releases will be done as rolling releases, which fits perfectly with Tumbleweed. And OpenSUSE Cubic is also based on the SUSE Tumbleweed RPMs. So every time we release an OpenSUSE Tumbleweed snapshot, we will release at the same time in the future an OpenSUSE Cubic snapshot. We have our own installer. It's still Yast, but it's only a one-page installer. Later more about this. And as a picture, you have your containers, you have a MicroS, Cubic, whatever you call it, which is driving all this. And so how is the system infrastructure is looking like? It's designed to fit together with our current infrastructure. So if you have SMT servers, SSC server, whatever, for the CAS part, it works together with them. For OpenSUSE Cubic, you don't need that, but you can still mirror your OpenSUSE Tumbleweed repos with SMT. We have an administration node. On this administration node, we have running the dashboard, which is doing the cluster configuration for you. So defining which cluster node has which role as Kubernetes master, worker, etcd, server, whatever. And logging is done where we don't provide an own logging infrastructure or monitorer infrastructure because most people have already something in their data center. So we decided we provide the syslog daemon and you can forward it to a central log server, whatever.
Just one thing. So one of the things that have been taken in consideration while better? Yeah, okay. So while we were looking at this, what we tried to do was to have a look at what we already had in terms of infrastructure way of doing things. And we tried to look at what we could actually keep as it was. Simply because we realized that while it's important to have finally a way to, you know, give our community and to our customers as well easily configurable working version of Kubernetes, we also didn't want them to just throw away everything that they had so far. So in that picture, you can see several bits and pieces that you should be quite familiar with. Behind the concepts that Torsten mostly used for MicroS, you will see all things that should be quite familiar to you as SUSE users. So for example, one of the things that we are highly relying on is AutoYast. That should be quite familiar for everyone. But we wanted to have a way to go away from this general purpose and from this PAT kind of machine to actually have something can be used as a base for Kubernetes. We had the advantage of having finally a single use case that we could concentrate on. This means cut away or rethink everything that you want to put in it so to make sure that everything that you have is something that only serves the purpose. And as Torsten was mentioning, this doesn't necessarily mean that this is going to be very small. That's not the point. The point is for you to know exactly what is running on that machine. It's for you to be able to easily replace this machine whenever there is a problem or a reason to do so. It's a way of basically abstracting all the workloads and the complexity on a different level so that you don't necessarily need to be a Kubernetes expert from one side to have I will go see if it's something for you, see if you want to use containers or not. And at the same side, on the other side, is a way of abstracting the complexity of managing an infrastructure that you don't really care about. One of the points is that if you want Kubernetes running, it's not because you love to administer thousands of machines, it's just because you want to run Kubernetes. And one of the things that we're trying to do is exactly this. So try to make the management of the infrastructure as easy as possible and as painless as possible for the admin, so that you can actually take some time and concentrate on whatever is on top of the stack. Sorry for the hijack.
No problem. Okay. So we don't make only an announcement theoretical here, but we have, of course, since 2 days, ISO images, which you can download and install. Thanks to Dominic, who even stopped check-ins for Tumbleweed for some hours until we get out working images. So there are ISO images which you can download and install. I will show the URL later. But of course, the project or product is not done yet. We don't have everything finished. So the SUSE micro OS, so the OS part, is ported to OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. This includes all features like the Docker engine, like Kubernetes, and so on. But, for example, the containers for the administration dashboard are still missing. We only have them currently internal on slash 12. We still need to port them. But we have an DBD to install from it. And then afterwards, Docker is running, and you can already play with it. And you can also configure Kubernetes at your own, if you think you can do that.
So one thing about the missing bits and pieces for the containers, we are definitely not there. We are starting catching up speed with this, but the pieces are still missing. If you have a look on the Docker Hub, you are probably going to see several containers under the OpenSUSE namespace. Some of them are the ones that we are currently using. You probably will see a few about MariaDB, Salt, and other bits and pieces. But for example, Vellum, that is the dashboard for doing the deployment, the maintenance afterwards, is not yet there. So what you should expect at this point in time is going to be to see the number of containers there growing, and you also should be able to start having a look at it and see more or less where we're heading to. One of the things that it's currently hindering us from publishing everything is the fact that very possibly and very soon we will re-architect to go for a fully containerized control plane. That also means we would like to avoid to have, let's say, an old kind of architecture available for a couple of days when we are planning to move things around once over again. Nevertheless, I believe that you will also have the links to the GitHub project for that. And after this, I will really let Thorsten talk. The only thing that I wanted to say is that this is, at least under my personal perspective, something that's supposed to be an incubator for ideas. That means we don't necessarily want to give you the same experience or the same kind of restrictions that you may want to have in an enterprise environment. I would like to see this project to gain some community. I would like this project to gain some traction within and outside OpenSUSE and collect your ideas, because what you can bring to the project is very possibly something very different from the standard enterprise customer that will just, you know, talk to us regarding SUSE Container as a Service platform. This is not the same. This should go in the same direction, but this is something that will benefit from different views coming from all of you. So if you have some time to spare, if you're interested in containers, please pass by, say hi afterwards, and we can talk more about this. And now back to you.
Okay, so what we also plan to deliver are images for Xen, KVM, VMware, so ready to run, that you only need to start them in your virtual environment. We are still working on them. Also, integration in OpenQA is missing, but we have OpenQA tests internal, and that is the next step we will do. That OpenSUSE Cubic will also, the OpenQA test will be there, and OpenSUSE Cubic will go through the review process like every other package for OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. And documentation, we have documentation, but currently it's only the SUSE CAS platform documentation, but except that there some version numbers for kernel whatever is not identical, of course, it's valid for OpenSUSE Cubic 2. Links at the end, where you can find them. So something about the design. What are the highlights of it? One of the goals we had was we want that the customer puts the CD into his machine, install it, and then he can start working with it. We don't want it that somebody has to learn 3 months how to configure Kubernetes, and if he has learned it after 3 months, then there's already the next major Kubernetes version and everything is void what he learned. So you install it and it's ready to run. We set up everything for you. We also will use ButterFS with snapshots and rollback for transactional updates. We have a read-only root file system with overlife S for etc, so that you can make configuration changes to it. The initial configuration, if necessary, will be done via cloud init. And if network and accounts are set up with cloud init, we will take over with salt from the administration dashboard and configure the rest of the system. And you have an administration node with a dashboard to manage the cluster, where you add and remove nodes and tell the nodes which their work is in the cluster. So the delivery we plan for OpenSUSE Cubic, it's at first, of course, an installer for bare metal. With this, you install the administration node. Additionally, you can install additional cluster nodes. But if you have a bigger cluster, you don't want to go around and install from DVD. Instead, we will also provide images which you can use for Pixie boot or copy on USB stick with an AutoJAS profile and then go around, and all additional cluster nodes will be installed automatically, register automatically at the dashboard, and then you only need to accept it and the dashboard in the cluster and assign them the role, and that was all. So the package format, if you look at other operating systems with transactional update and Kubernetes container, whatever, you will see most of the time that they have invented a new package format, that there are special requirements that you need, for example, 15 partitions or something similar for it. We decided to stay with RPM for the package format for several reasons. It's a well-known format used by several major distributions. We have a working tool chain from building RPMs to delivery to the customer. The customers have their own chain from getting updates via RPM, applying their policy on it in regards of what they need to test, when they will accept it, how to apply it. And this all still continues to work if we stay with RPM. RPMs are signed, so easy to verify from where they came and if they are installed correctly. And we have the Delta RPMs to save bandwidth. And in the end, we didn't find any requirement where we would have said, that's not doable with RPM. There are some features in RPM which are not that practical for transactional update and read-only file system, but if you don't use it, then everything is okay there.
But I guess that is fair enough to say that back then, when the decision was done, we actually thought about if we should stay with RPMs or not. So that was never since day one.
Correct. So the first requirement was we need to do everything new. And when we looked at what other did some brainstorming, came up with other solutions, in the end we decided there is no advantage for us, only a lot of additional work. It's more opposite. Some or a lot of the solutions would have drawbacks. So it was not that we said we have RPMs, we stay with it, but that was really evaluation work at the beginning. About the configuration, as already said, the system should be pre-configured as far as possible. So in the best case, no additional configuration by the sysadmin is needed. That's not always possible. So if there is something you need to reconfigure, we use Cloud Init in the beginning. With this, you can set up the network, you can configure Salt to find the Salt master. You can install your own public keys for SSH to log in on the machine. And if Salt minions are configured, you can then take over from the Salt master and configure other things like password, time zone, keyboard, NTP. But you can also do it with Cloud Init from the beginning. That's up to the admin what he prefers. And as said, we use ButterFS with snapshots which are read-only. Which on the other side means since the whole transaction update process is based on snapshots from ButterFS, we only support ButterFS as root file system for OpenSUSE Cubic or for CASP, no other file system. If other file systems come up with same functionality in regards to snapshots and rollback, we will re-evaluate this, but currently ButterFS is the only supported file system. If you look at the layout, it's similar like SLES or OpenSUSE Tumbleweed in regards to snapshots and rollback. The only difference is the root file system, so the root subvolume is read-only, and the subvolumes are not created to prevent them from landing in the snapshot, but to have some read-write-able spaces where you can store log files, configurations, whatever there is needed. For the etc directory, we use the overlay file system so that you can make changes to it. We were also looking at the beginning if you use a stateless system, which means the configuration you made is deleted at a reboot and then reapplied with CloudInit and salt. But in the end, we decided by looking at the files that over 90% of the normally modified files are of the kind you don't want to lose this information because then a lot of other things will stop work. So we don't use a full stateless system, but it's still possible to do it, but we don't recommend that. We have a lot of subvolumes. We have even quite some more as slash 12 had. The main problem we are facing with this was varlib. On the one side, we wanted or needed to have varlib read-write for a lot of applications. On the other side, we have information stored there, like the RPM database, which need to be part of the root file system. So we couldn't exclude it by making the whole varlib subdirectory read-write in own subvolume. This is some work for the future where we need to think about if it wouldn't be better to move, for example, the RPM database to user, because that's where the RPMs are installed and where the data is, metadata should also be there, but not today, maybe something later. So how do we update the systems? At first, as I already said, we use transactional updates for it. If you are interested in how transactional updates works in details, in about 1 hour and 50 minutes, I will have an own talk here about transactional updates. So I will only follow shortly one slide later with the definition of transactional updates. All updates are applied automatically. This can be disabled. You can define a maintenance window in which this update should be applied and the machine rebooted. And you can define other policies, how the machines should be updated and rebooted. We use standard RPMs with SIPA, Snapper, and ButterFS procs. So we didn't need to invent anything new there, except a script around this update, who is doing the updates. So,
so just one thing about the updates, at least for the upper part of the stack. We actually had quite some challenges about this. And some of them are still ongoing. We are working on that, but things were not exactly easy. So we are starting to change things from a single machine to a cluster of machines, and we also start changing the roles, the roles of those machines and the way in which they're updated actually makes a huge difference. So we try to abstract that kind of complexity from the base OS in that case, and we are relying on an additional layer of orchestration to make sure that all the right bits and pieces are updated at the right time. But I have to say that that has been quite an interesting exercise.
Okay, so as I said, we use or deliver the updates in the same way as OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. In the end, even if it is called OpenSUSE Cubic, you will add the OpenSUSE Tumbleweed update repos, you will get the RPMs from there, you will see all OpenSUSE Tumbleweed updates in this channels, but we will only use the updates for the RPMs we have installed. And so the process for get updating, updates, fixes and features into OpenSUSE Cubic is the same as you would use Orgao to get it into OpenSUSE Tumbleweed for it. The definition of what transactional updates is, that's quite important. So a transactional update should be atomic. Either the update is fully applied or not at all. And the update does not influence your running system. Why is it important? So if you have a big cluster and you want to automatically stay on sync with them with updates, have applied all major security and bug fixes automatically, you don't want to risk that these machines get corrupt and then you need to reinstall, debug, fix them. So we want to make sure that if we apply an update, then it's really done correct and not the system is afterwards broken. And why it is important that the update does not influence your running system. Only think about the Docker engine. If you update the Docker engine and it is restarted, then all your containers currently running are gone. So this is something you don't want. If you have long-running containers, you don't want that they will be shut off only because there is a minor update, whatever.
Just another thing. Another point that brought us to this decision is the fact that we wanted those systems to be as predictable as possible, simply because by knowing to a very high degree how the system is going to look like and to know what to expect, this also allows us to do all the additional layer of configuration that Tosin was mentioning before. So it's a very different thing if you don't know what to expect compared to if you already know exactly how the system is supposed to look like at that specific point in time. Also, if you are applying, as he was mentioning, slightly more invasive kind of updates, you have the entire time, or at least you still have a chance to plan exactly and decide how things will look once the machine is rebooting. That is quite different from, yeah, just updating an RPM on the running system and more or less see what happens.
So, okay, and the second part is, can be rolled back. So assume you get a new kernel update, afterwards the machine doesn't boot anymore. You want to have an easy way to go back to the state before the kernel update and get your systems running again. And that is possible with ButterFS, SnapForce and Rollback, like we do with Less and OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. Which packages does OpenSUSE Cubic contain? It contains all packages which are needed to boot the system, to configure the and run the stack on top of it, so Kubernetes, Docker engine, whatever is needed there. But it is no general purpose OS. So logging onto the console, install some nice games, whatever you want there, is not the way to go here. But your workload has to be run inside of a container. So new packages will be introduced if needed. Packages which are no longer needed will be removed, which also means we don't guarantee any ABI for your application. That's why you also should put your workload into a container. But of course, as we said, I said in the beginning, we don't bring our own monitoring or logging solution. There are needs to install additional RPMs, like monitoring, like logging, or if you need special drivers for your hardware, like KMP packages, this is all possible. You can install your own RPMs, additional one to it. You are not limited to what we provide. So about the installer, we made quite some changes there too. At first, the most important thing is you can choose between three different kinds of setup. The most common way is you install an administration node with a dev board, and afterwards you install via Pixieboot or other machines in the cluster and get the Autodesk profile from the dev board. For evaluation, demonstrating whatever, or if you have a small cluster, it's also nice to only install the cluster nodes directly from the DVD. So you have to choose the role cluster nodes. And if you only want to look at what is the OS doing, how it looks like, does it run on my hardware, you can select no services, which means the system comes up and boots, but then you go to the dev prompt and you have to configure everything at your own. The installed RPMs in all three cases are always the same, only the difference of which services are enabled is different. The difference is which services are enabled and running and which containers are installed. So with Cloud Init, for example, you can decide at every boot if this is now an administration node, a cluster node, or whatever. The installation media is similar to OpenSUSE Tumbleweed or Leap. It's a DVD with the RPMs and the installer. We also have an RPM created, I think, part of Cubic, but we need to add it, which provides an installer ready to run for PXE boot, or you can copy the content on a USB stick, make that boot able. So you have only the installer and can install from it, no need to download the full DVD if you want to do only network installations. So we've also changed the workflow of the installer and created something like we called one-page installer. You have one page with some few informations we need from you. You need to enter there and that's all we ask you. The partitioning is done fully automatically. The behavior is similar to slash 12 and it's only visible if there are errors or no automatic proposal is possible. We automatically create a ButterFS root file system with subvolumes, install the base OS into the first snapshot and configure and install the bootloader, that's all. And that's how the one-page installer is looking like. You can see registration code and SMT server URL. We didn't have the time to disable this for Cubic now because it's not needed there. But else, you enter the password, you force the keyboard layout, you for the system role, for the administration server, we need additional a list of NTP servers so that the time in the cluster is correct. And there are more on the right side if you really need to change some things, but normally don't need to bother with that. So what are the differences compared to a standard OpenSUSE Tumbleweed installation? So the first thing is update of packages. Cubic will come with a read-only root file system. There is a script called transaction update. You call that with updatepatch to update the system. Instead of zipper up, you call then zipper, transaction update up. You can install additional packages or PTFs. It's coming from slash, so we call it PTFs, even if you don't have them, but in the end, it will install RPMs which are either local or in a repository you added. Rollback is not done by snapper rollback, but transaction update rollback. If you use KDAMP, there were also some changes because we don't have a YAST module. KDAMP cannot generate its initRD at the first boot, so it's all done by the transaction update script. And if you use AutoYAST install with it, then you need to configure to only run in the first stage only mode because there is no second stage available. We don't have any YAST modules on the system. So now you want to test it. I think everybody wants to test it. You can download ISO images and do the QA for us because, as I said, OpenQA is not yet configured to automatically test it. I did some testing 2 days ago and it was working for me. If you want to read more documentation about it, currently we only have the beta program documentation for CASP, but everything written there is also valid for OpenSUSE Cubic. On GitHub you can find the project for the Velum dashboard and other things, but since we didn't want to create an own product at its own in this way, a lot of or most of the features for Cubic are also useful for OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, which means the code is in a lot of different OpenSUSE devil projects, so where they belong thematically into it. We don't have everything at its own, but really try to incorporate everything in Tumbleweed, so it's also useful for other people. So if you would like to play with transaction updates, it's there in OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. You can install the package and play with it or use it. And the same is true for all other packages. And now comes the end or your questions. Are there any questions about this? Okay, now if you get some air, you can speak.
So I take it with it requiring all the factory-based repositories or the tumbleweed-based repositories and the develop projects, it depends on what targets are enabled for those repositories. So I'm thinking of running Kubik on non-x86. Yeah, so... Is it possible to run Kubik on other architectures apart from x86? So maybe doing a Kubik cluster on Raspberry Pis is an example.
So you mean if you can Kubik on which architectures you can run it?
Yeah.
So currently we only enabled x86-64 because of missing resources and time. The plan is to enable all architectures. The biggest problems are there. Can the architecture run really containers? Is there good support for it? And the second one is there a working Go version for this architecture? These are the most two biggest issues we need to invest quite heavily, and that's why we haven't yet enabled all architectures. More questions? No questions anymore, or anybody too shy to ask? Okay, if there are no questions anymore, then I give you 15 minutes back for break to drink something or whatever else. Thank you.